come to his courts with his gates of thanksgiving, his courts with praise. When we come in, let's do that. Let's just come into his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Nothing is more important than the protocol of the king. Nothing. And when we get to that place where we're not so offended by that statement, by the way, because believe me, in some places around the earth, if you don't follow it, they don't worry about you being offended when you're sitting down in the street or arrested for not following protocol. But our king deserves so much. When we come into that place, that our hearts are prepared to give him thanksgiving and to give him praise. And when we talk, let's come in and recall the great deeds that the Lord is doing. We just thank you, Lord. I'm going to give one great report. 5 years, thousands of miles, thousands of dollars, and Elva got her green card yesterday. Yeah. After all this time, Elva just got her green card yesterday. Elva. 5 years. She's been here legal, but now she's here permanently legal. And I told her next time she's going to go across the river, I'll pick her up on the other side. So bienvenidos a Estados Unidos. Welcome to the United States. Presencia aquí es muy importante para nuestro país. Your presence here is very important for our country. Pero más importante, tú eres mi vida. Y tú eres nuestra familia. But what's most important is you're my life, you're my love, and you're our family. I'll ask her later if I said it right. Did I? Ah, see. Oh, isn't he worthy to be praised? Just think about all, what has he done? What has he done this week? Yes, with all the rain, still, what has he done all this week? Just give him praise. See, it's up to us to turn our minds. It's not up to wait for the Holy Spirit, the anointing. Don't do that. That's what babies need. They wait for mama to bring the bottle. But mature, go to the refrigerator. Some of us are very mature. You understand the difference? Some of us, we've been groomed to think that we... Let me help something here. Some of us have been groomed and stayed at a place where we're waiting for the milk to come to us, the anointing to fall. But some just flow in the anointing and go right to the source. And see, that's where when we come in, that your heart is set. Everyone has had things from work, everything's had things from the weather. And when we come in, we go, I'm in the throne room of God and I'm going to give him and minister to him. Regardless, nothing else is more important. Yes, they're very important, don't get me wrong. But consider him who sits on the throne. Consider the moon and the stars that he has ordained. What is man that thou art mindful of him, or the son of man that you would even visit him? We just give you praise. As we worship tonight, this is what I'm going to ask of you. That if you feel over there there's the elements for communion, go ahead and take the elements. The body that we are part of, that was broken for us so we can become part of. And the blood, the most amazing thing about the blood. Just feel free to go over and take it at your leisure. The blood shed for us, the perfect Lamb of God. From the Son of Man and also the Son of God in one being. How incredible is that?
Us, picked us out for himself as his own in Christ before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy, consecrated, and set apart for Him and blameless in His sight, even above reproach before Him in love. For He foreordained us, destined us, planned in love for us, to be adopted, revealed as His own children through Jesus Christ, in accordance with the purpose of His will, because it pleased Him and was His kind intent, so that we might be in the praise of His glorious grace, favor, and mercy, which He is so freely bestowed on us in the Beloved. In Him we have redemption, deliverance, and salvation through His blood, the remission of our offenses, our sins, shortcomings, and trespasses, in accordance with the riches and the generosity of His gracious with Him, the pleasure, His merciful intention, which He had previously purposed and set forth in Him. He planned for the maturity of the times and the climax of the ages to unify all things and head them up and consummate them in Christ. Thank you.
Lord. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. We bless you, God. We thank you and we honor your name, Lord. We bless you, God. We thank you for your grace and mercy, Jesus. We thank you, God. You are worthy to be praised, Lord. You are worthy to be praised, God. You're everything, Jesus. You fill the earth and the heavens, God, with your glory, Jesus Christ. You are wonderful, Lord. You are beautiful, God. We bless you and we thank you, Lord. We stand in awe of you, God. You are amazing. You're beautiful, Lord. You are wonderful, Jesus. You are wonderful. We have no words. We have no words to describe what our hearts feel when we enter into your courts, when we enter into that place before the throne of your Father. It's just amazing, God. It's just your grace. It is just your love. And it is just your mercy, Jesus. We bless you and we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Jesus Christ, for opening the way, Jesus, through your blood, through your sacrifice, through your sufferings, through your love, through your mercy, your compassion. You open the way. Open the way, a wide open way for your children to run into the arms of the Father, to bless him, to see his face, to honor him, to worship him, to rejoice around his throne, to receive all that amazing grace, amazing love, and amazing power that makes us beings, supernatural beings that are just natural in this realm, Jesus, in this place where you have taken us up higher, up higher, up higher, up higher, at your feet.
just felt and feel it for the last couple of minutes, the influx of angelic presence. I'm not spooky. Those of you who know me have never heard me say this. It's an influx of angels, not because they're on assignment to us, though they are in a sense. They're joining us in the sounds of worship because it is so magnificent to them. See, we come into the place, you have to understand, we come into a place to bless the King of Glory in the heavenly place with full consciousness. That the angels marvel at that. Because they hear us as royalty blessing the King. The angels are not royalty, they're made by royalty. But we were made royalty. And when they hear the sounds of the heavens radiating from the earth, they rush to join, to assist. Their frequencies actually can be heard. Not by human ears like we know it. But at times we get glimpses. And if you hear that flowing, I'm saying this is a testimony to the Father and to what's happening here. They are marveled and they desire for us to enter into this season with eyes wide open. They want to guide us. They want to help us. Like, don't go that way. Don't go and stay this way. But they hear the minister too. But they're amazed to hear royalty ministering to the Father. Not focused on just the members, but ministering to the Father as one voice from the heart. It all begins there. So we bless you, Father. We don't put our eyes on angels. We don't put our eyes on those things. We put our eyes on Him, the author and the finisher of our faith. And we bless. If you want to send all the hosts of heaven, Lord, that's up to you. But we will bless you. Because you are worthy of all praise. And we ascribe to you glory. a few moments in our hearts straightening out. What could take teaching years to begin to even think we have to hear something? See, we're coming into an era. Let me explain. I have a prophetic word to give tonight, and I need to give it. We're coming into apostolic reformation, is what we're coming into. The definition that we've ever had of apostle in our current state overall is not really accurate. I'm just going to say, and I'll take the heat for it, because what can man do to me? Apostolic reformation means that the one that's grounded, the one that guides in truth, is the one that lifts up and finds the precious in each one of you. It's not the one you serve. It's not the one you bow down to. It's not the one you cower under. It's the one that helps you find the precious in you, but they're solid on the word of the one who sent him. That's an apostolic reformation, a reforming. It's going to turn it upside down and become the foundation like it was always meant to be. Not a program of a planned event of our evangelizing world. Because when we lift up those and find the precious in them, they're going into the streets and telling about it. They're going to be sent into the streets. I know it's true. I've witnessed it. But this spirit of religion that's been on this property, not property, on this land, that the longer we've been here, the more accustomed we grow to. And there's this lie that we think that the rest of Christendom is like this. And it is not. I'm first here to tell you, it is not. I had a quick conversation and texted my brother. You know, I've been to the Orient a dozen times. And the amazing thing when they hear it, see, they don't hear the gospel of the church. They don't even hear the gospel of salvation. You know what they hear? The gospel of the kingdom. Because they're dynasty. They think in terms of lineage. So why do they hate the Japanese, let's say? You know why? Because we think, let bygones be bygones. It's true. All that happened so long in the past, brother, you know. But then, they're looking at a lineage that still exists that aren't their lineage, and that's in their presence. See, that's how they think. Well, we lost one light bulb, right? That's all right. Oh, I know what happened. We got to flip the breaker switch on that thing again. It's probably overloaded. Pull something out. And see, isn't that funny when the power of the word comes? You know, you get things started happening. How long has it been coming? It hasn't even happened yet. Don't worry about it. You can live with that. Maybe. No, don't. No. Anyway, so, nice. See how that moves. See, let me tell you, when words are given, distractions happen. I gotta tell you, they always do. And it always does. It always happens. So, they think in terms of lineage. And the reason that they get empowered and lifted up in the precious, see, they're not looking for someone to lord over them. They're actually looking to serve somebody. And we think it's an opportunity for someone. But no, any one of them can lead. But what they do is they prefer one another because the foundation they're on is on the lineage of a new royal lineage. And his name is Jesus Christ. See, they're really, there's an understanding. And because of that, their duty is then to pass the gospel on to you, and the gospel of the kingdom is to find out how not only to bring you into the kingdom, but then what your precious, what your place is in that kingdom. That's an apostolic reformation. We don't look to build our ministry, we look to build you. And then in that, when we come and bless the Lord, we're looking for the precious. And see, here's what begins to happen as we begin to form. Because I'm telling you what, you know what? Do you know what's happening here? Do you know what matter this is that we're following? In this gathering, we call it. It's the same pattern that they did at Antioch. They came and blessed the Lord and ministered to the Lord, then they took care of business. And teachers are going to teach more about that. Apostolic Reformation. I mean, I'm calling on it. Teach it. The apostolic is Reformation, what the order is, and the order of an Antioch church. You know, and my guys, my elders, they tell me this, they say, you want to see a strong body and a strong regional church? And by the way, the eyes around them, I didn't know this, but they're watching this region because of what's happening here. Not I'm talking about the storm, I'm talking about the region. But they say, you need to have these things. Worship, right? Intercession and prayer, the Word of God, and missions. And if you're not saving the lost, what are you doing? If you're not ministering, what are you doing? Right? If you're not feeding, right? Does that make sense? So I submit to that, and what we're doing, what's happening here, and the reason the heavens show up so much, just pull that plug out. The reason this is so funny. We've been doing this since 2012 when this started, and this is the first time I'm decreeing something and saying these things, and I can feel the opposition, not from you, I can feel it. I can feel it. I've been amazed to watch what the hunger that's come up in such gifted people in this past year and a half, especially, that nobody is worried about their ministry growing and people being recognized, the ones that God is forming. See, He's forming a council. And the reason it's so powerful is because everyone prefers one another. No one's trying to lord over each other. And the truth of the matter is, we just sense the anointing, we sense who the King is giving commission to at that moment, we just follow that. It's really simple. And we get sensitive that, and what's happening as we grow, we're learning to keep our eyes focused on the King. That when we gather together in solemn assemblies, our focus is not to the people, it's to Him. And what then happens, that's why it's so powerful, what then happens, He turns that around and then begins to minister to us as we minister to Him. Does that make sense? We have to trust Him. That's what's happening here right now, right in this place. So I believe that we're coming into an apostolic reformation. I don't use big terms like that normally, but I don't know what else to call it. I am not calling anybody an apostle. I am not into titles, not into that. It's just the word of a governmental order that's coming forth. See, the government is upon his shoulders. So we have to recognize it. And see, as he moves, we have eyes, are getting eyes to see him moving, that's him speaking. And I ask, Lord, why are you forming a council? I'm not talking about a committee members or council members or anything like that. And by the way, I've heard murmuring in the community about that. See, we're not talking about church committees, not church board. But there's no church board run thing going on here. It's just us blessing the Lord. There's no permission given by the board to sit here and bless the Lord. We just bless the Lord because He's worthy. We come together to bless the Lord because He's worthy. And because He wants to talk to us corporately, He summons us. So we come, and in an assembly, and then as a council, we know, because it's elders amongst us, the spirit of truth, or what's truth of the word, because we have the word, remember? Worship, intercession, word, missions. We have the word, so we are safe amongst each other because we have the word. And so if something counterfeit walks in, because we know the truth, it's like dark trying to walk in the light. It just doesn't happen. Does that make sense? The other thing that it does is it protects against the prophetic abuses. Now, I'm just going to say it, that have gone on for years. People want to label me as a prophet and travel as a prophet. Go ahead, that's fine. You can call me that. A prophet basically gives an exhortive comfort, exhortation, comfort, and edification builds up. It can foretell, but really the office of the prophet, you know what their role is this, to open up for the heavens to come and for you to enter in. That's what Elijah called down for the heavens, meaning the earth. You understand, and opening up. That's what the office of the prophet does. The words of knowledge that people give, they call themselves prophets, I don't want to debate with them. Okay? You understand? I'm not getting into that. And I'm not calling them out. I'm just saying that there's a reformation going on because we don't run after ministerial gifts. We run after Him and in His presence in His throne room. And in that place, He then says, I will teach you. Isaiah 2 says, come up the mountain of the Lord to the house of Jacob in these last days. Paraphrasing. And I will show, I will teach you. He said, I will rebuild the tabernacle that's fallen. He said all these things. So do we believe Him? I do. So what do I know to do? This is why we come and bless the Lord. Because in the tabernacle of David, when he established the ark, the tabernacle, and brought the ark up correctly, and then subsequently, Hezekiah and Josiah and Nehemiah, you know, well, he was part of that. All the guys that did restorations, they followed the order of David. But you know, David, you know what he had to follow? The reason he got corrected? Is he didn't follow the order of Moses. But once he completed it and an everlasting covenant was made, they all followed the order of David after that. And David, we are in Him who's the Son of David. Matthew 1:1, Jesus Christ, Son of David. We're in Him. Jesus Christ is the Son of David. And the reason I bring this up is if He's going to restore a tabernacle, there is an order that He's already put into His book. He's already written. Just like David had to learn, the reason that we lost Uzzah the high priest is because we, and God did a breach upon us, is because we didn't follow the due order, that which was written in the times of Moses. It's written. And you know what it writes? That He would restore the tabernacle. That He would restore it. That He would build it. So the only way I know to do that is the first thing He did when He put the Ark of the Covenant in the middle is He put government officials around the Ark that they would bless the Lord continually. They were chief musicians, but don't get that confused. Oh, they were the worship guys. Don't do that. Don't do that. That's what the modern day did, like Saul did. Put the musicians in the corner and only summon them for their need. That is not what they put here. Now, I'm not saying this because I'm a musician. I'm saying it because I'm governmental. They were placed there because their function was to continually bless the Lord. That was their job. And then to teach all the subsequent their generations. So when we come here, if I sound like a broken record emphatically saying, bless the Lord, bless the Lord, bless the Lord, it's because He promised us that He would build it. I have built dozens of buildings and have been to over 20 countries, ministering over 30, I've stepped foot in, and I'm telling you, He said, I'm spitting, I'm so, He said He would build it. You said You would build it. So we come and bless You in Your holy place and You build it. And we will allow this reformation to take place. We'll allow You to form it. But Lord, silence the words against Your work. Silence the words that men want to call out and because of the resentment of past systems, want to call what you're doing is saying system, and it's not. So when he calls a solemn assembly, when he calls a council together, you can guarantee this, he's about to move. If we let go and stop trying to reach God through a system and reach him through, you know why we can't reach him through the system? Because the system is not the way. Jesus said, nobody comes to the Father except through me. And then how do we get there? We bless him. He's in a great place. You are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people set apart to show forth the praises of him who's called you out of darkness into this marvelous light. So have your way, O God. Have your way. Have your way. Days that you would take us up your mountain to the house of Jacob, you would teach us your ways, you would teach us. So Father, in this reforming that you're doing, protect our mouths, protect our minds, protect us from speaking ill against something that you are forming. And Lord, let us lift up the sound of praise from the earth. And Lord, you said you inhabit the praises of your people. Have your way, oh God. We are desperate. fire, the light's actually vibrating over your head. Or is that your, is that your wife blowing sweet nothings in your ear? Oh, we have fun in the Lord, don't we?
That too. Well, I was sitting back there the whole time. I was first person I was seeing. This is what I was seeing in the spirit. Actually, there's a scripture associated with it in Psalm 32. What I'm seeing in the spirit is that I'm seeing it's like the Lord's crafting arrows. And it's like I'm in first person looking through his eyes. And he's got all these, and and there's such a delight, such a contentment in doing it. It's like the arrows are living. I'm talking about as a bow and arrow, A-R-R-O-W. And what I'm sensing is the Lord is imprinting upon us his contentment, his good pleasure. Not in the doing or even fulfilling ministry callings, and not even being sent forth from his presence as an arrow. As the psalmist said, I will instruct you and teach you in the ways you go. I'll guide you with my eye. The word teach there literally means to aim as an arrow. Isn't that interesting? I will instruct you. I will imprint upon you. I will meticulously and with great care make you precise, make you straight, ready for my purposes, kingdom purposes in these last days. But says that's not where you're going to find your satisfaction and your fulfillment. No, it's in my hands. It's being with me as I imprint upon you, as my fingerprints are covered over every aspect of your life. It's just with being with me. Even if you're just a dead piece of wood that has not even been started on yet, the Lord says, you're in my hands. You're in the place I desire you to be. The end result will come. He says, because you have learned not to be like the horse or like the mule, which have no understanding, which must be harnessed with bit and bridle. Don't say in your hearts, maybe, maybe, if great calamity will come, and then we'll see the purposes of God fulfilled. No. Realize that if you were instructed and taught by me, if you're aimed by me in the way you should go, then you'll be guided by my eye, and there will be a precision. There'll be an accuracy that my people have not known. And the Lord says, that's what I'm looking for in these last days, is a precision and an accuracy, but that only comes with my eye. That as you seek my face and yield to my molding on the inside, he says, don't wait for difficulties before you decide to surrender your whole life, every aspect of your life to me. Don't wait for great hardship. It says, no. No one understand that my purposes and my design is done in these times, in places like this, in the secret place, in the hidden place. In that place, the Lord says, you're molded. You're molded. You're designed. You're made precise. You're made accurate. And in that place, the Lord says, alone is contentment, is satisfaction. In my presence is fullness of joy, and at my right hand are pleasures. Stir you to discontent. precision, you'll know accuracy. Apostolically, prophetically, pastorally, evangelistically, and as teachers of my word, you will find such an accuracy that many will come to hear the law proceed out of Zion, because out of Zion my law will go forth out of my holy hill. From a pure priesthood, those are not competing with one another, even though one may be designed unto one end and one with another. The contentment and the pleasure that comes from being with me, being molded by my hands, that makes you one. That makes you equal. Not necessarily equal in effectiveness, equal in anointing, equal in focus, but equal before me. The same access, the same hands, the same eye, the same countenance. You are before me, the Lord says, as my arrows. Beautiful. Beautiful. Some of you are unfinished. Some of you have been shot forth already, and you've returned back. And many more assignments are ahead. Many more are ahead. The Lord says, I've called you out of those who've been as horses and as mules, and you've been frustrated by them. But the Lord says, this is your hour where your frustrations are coming to an end, where precision and accuracy will be the crown of my people, because they are guided by my eye.
Sensing a word that the Lord is speaking about the gates, and this
sent
gate,
forth from it.
This gate that he was showing me was the gate called the Beautiful. And in that gate, there was a lame man sitting, waiting to receive something. And he was a beggar. And he was there for years and years. They would carry him as he was seated at the gate. And the Lord is saying to his people, you have been at the entrance, in that access that you've been hoping for, and you see it, and you've been crying, and you've been asking for a breakthrough, to cross over to the other side, for access to go through the gate. And I've been hearing your petitions day and night, and I am a righteous judge, and I listen, and I listen. And as this beggar was was looking at the eyes of the disciples as they were coming in, and they looked at his eyes. And he asked, and he was expecting to receive from them. He didn't know exactly what to ask. He was maybe settling for a few coins. But he was asking, he was expecting. And the Lord says, I've seen you. I've seen you looking at me with expectation. I see around the earth and I see faith. I see faith. My children expecting. Looking at me and I look at them. And I'm telling you, I'm releasing my power. Signs and wonders, miracles. And I'm giving you what you've been asking for. I'm saying to you, get up. Get up and walk. Get up. Come out. Come away. Come out of that place. Because I'm taking you to higher places. I'm taking you to a place where you can stand before my throne. The door is open for you. And you will stand not as a beggar. But now, that was in the past. But today I'm telling you, my son, my daughter, I'm crowning you with my authority to stand before my throne, to speak, to declare and to decree my will for your life, for your family, for your community, for your nation and for the nations. This is the time I'm saying, get up, stand. And speak with faith and expectation, knowing that there is nothing impossible for me. And I will give you more than what you expect or think. I will exceed it abundantly to you, my child, my church, in this time, in this hour. I'll rise to your position, to your kingly position. Arise to your kingly position. Arise in my word, because my word abides in you. And you're not speaking out of your own mind or of your own heart or selfish desires, but you're speaking through my word, through my will, through my guidance. I have put my breath in you and I have breathed in you life. So the words you speak are life, and they bring life, and they bring forward life to what is my will on the earth as it is in the heavens. Open your mouth and speak and decree and declare. And bring my order from heaven to the earth. This is my command for you. I am the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You are my children. And you carry the authority in the kingdom. This is the kingdom age. This is the kingdom hour. To conquer, to rule, and to reign over your enemies. Arise with my authority and determination. When there is agreement with my spirit and your spirit, you will see great things and greater things. And where there is agreement in my body with my spirit, in the spirit of faith, there will be nothing that I will not do for you, my church, my beloved. Arise, arise and rejoice, as this man rejoiced in my presence as he entered in the temple walking. Dancing, jumping, rejoicing. This is my time, and this is the time where my church will rejoice in my deeds, in my works, my love, in the fulfillment of what you've been waiting and asking for. Now I stand and declare and decree, you've been healed, you've been made whole by the sacrifice, my son Jesus Christ. Arise and shine. This is the time to rejoice in my presence, says the Lord. Thank you.